My name is Theodore Spelter. I'm the Executive Director at the Toyota Vessels Institute for Manufacturing Studies. Well, my education started directly after school. I started to embark on a BCom degree at the Vol Triangle campus of Potchefstroom University those days. And I earned my BCom in business economics, and then I went on to get an honors in business management, and then I was offered a junior lectureship after completion of my honors degree. So I started my young career as a junior lecturer in the Vol Triangle at the Vol campus of the then Northwest University in 1995. So as a student directly after matric, I work at Natref, the refinery there in Sasolburg, during the December holiday. And that was operating on the tank farms and measuring the levels of the fuel, the crude oil. And then also during my university days, I did some holiday work at numerous companies, some of them like ACI, the old ISCO or Mittal Steel as we know it today. So those are some of my first jobs that I've done. Definitely not in my career scope. And then basically my first job then formally was then with the University of Northwest as a junior lecturer. Yep. I'm the executive director at the Toyota Vessels Institute for Manufacturing Studies, and I also hold the CFAO Research Chair. Well, the purpose includes the development of TWIMS into Africa's foremost manufacturing business education institution. It's there to foster relationships within the manufacturing sector and to ensure TWIMS financial sustainability. I think all academics would say is the day they attain full professorship, and for me, it's exactly the same. Most people not within the university fraternity don't understand the pressures and the challenges to be promoted to a full professorship, and overseas is called tenure. I was able to achieve that at Northwest University while I was at the Mafeking campus. I think after how many years in academia, 30, 40 years, there's many challenges. I would like to actually mention two. As a young academic, one of the key qualifications to obtain is the doctorate. And I really want to do a doctorate at an esteemed university. I think there was a bit of, let's call it pride, a bit of, you know, you see the all the shininess of these top prestige Ivy schools out there, and you thought, you know, what's your possibility to be able to study at one of those Ivy League universities and to obtain then a doctoral degree from them. So I did apply and I was successful at the Rotterdam School of Management, which was and is still today one of the top business schools in Europe and in the world. Their doctoral program is a four-year program, so they don't acknowledge your postgrad qualifications. You basically start as a B degree and you go through a four-year program, and it's quite a rigorous program with classes, etc. Unfortunately, as a South African just coming out of apartheid, getting a work permit was very difficult. So I got a temporary permit to get into the country, and every second week I had to go to what I call the Vreemdeling Police, which means it's the foreign police, and I was treated like a criminal every time you knock in there. And it went on for 6 months, and it really frustrated me because you couldn't focus on your studies. And you know, you reach the limits, and I decided to give that up. It was a decision that I make, not as a form of failure, but I thought to myself, this four-year program I can actually complete within 2 years in the South African university. So I came back to the original university that where I have completed my master's degree under the same supervisor. I was clever enough not to look for a new supervisor, so by now we know one another. And I actually finished that doctoral degree in a year and a half before I turned 30. So that was, for me, I think, out of a failure situation, turn it into a winning situation, because I think I focused on the big picture. I wanted to achieve the doc. I realized, you know, the esteem to have an Ivy League qualification beyond United, it's nice, but at the end of the day, well, especially if I'm going to work in South Africa and stay in South Africa, it's not going to give me such a big advantage. And I'd really rather have a look at the doctoral level of things. Yeah, so, you know, that was during my stint at Mafeking campus as director of the business school there. And that's where I realized getting to know a bit more of the corporate world and the cultures, as well as bureaucracy, as well as the individuals with jealousy and enviousness coming to the fore. There was a particular academic that was quite envious, and I only learned it afterwards, and he accused me of plagiarism of some of the work that I've done. And plagiarism is one of those things, it taints academics' career quite badly, as we have seen with the dean of Harvard Business School recently, where she was asked to resign in combination with some of the anti-Semitic remarks she made. But for any academic to be found out to commit plagiarism is one of the sins you can't do. I think that's a career stopper for any academic. So I realized I had to do something drastic to save myself, not because I was guilty, but because I know I was innocent. But what was available to me was very limited. A lot of hearsay, a lot of politics in the corridors, even my line manager distanced herself from me because I think they don't want to be tainted under the plagiarism accusation. So I quickly realized one needs to be resilient, but also be guided by experts. So I immediately contact a local lawyer, and he says, or he told me, we had to actually do the full Monty with this to protect yourself and to defend yourself. So this whole case went to the Northwest High Court, and it's currently a case where a defamation case was then brought against this individual after it was shown that I haven't done any plagiarism. And even the university, through their internal process later on, you know, cleared me. But the whole defamation case actually set in the standard that one can't go around, and especially in academia, make the claim that a peer have done plagiarism. And with that, as I said, the resilience, it took a few months to get to that point where my name was clear. A lot of money went involved, although in terms of the ruling by the court for the defamation, it was in excess of like 120, 140,000 rand that came my way. Just the legal cost was in the region of 80,000 rand. So it wasn't about the money. It was really about clearing one's name. The effort and the energy to get to the point where you can say you can go forth and you can put this behind you took a while, and it took a lot of energy. I think that was a big challenge for me, because I realized even a big organization like the Northwest University, where I was well-esteemed, well-liked, many people distance themselves because they are afraid to be associated who you are and what it could mean to them. So in that situation, I was really alone in the workplace, having to fend for myself, and I just quickly realized I have to be guided by experts. And I was lucky enough of a lawyer that quickly brought in an advocate, and that advocate, with his expertise, have actually shown the person that have defamed me in terms of this plagiarism cases that, you know, he came with cases without any support, without any experts. And I just quickly realized, even if one is right and you've got the evidence in front of you, there's a certain protocol to be followed, a certain process to be followed to be able to make your case. And if it's not your expertise, you'd rather stay away from it. And that was for me also a good learning experience to say, I could have ran away from this. I could have just attacked on this way, but I really have fought through this whole process and then rely on the guidance of these experts to be able to defend myself. I think I personally don't like conflict. Just because I don't like it doesn't mean it's not there. Conflict is always in the workplace. There's even a lot of disagreements, small things, nuances being, you know, say or not said, body languages, etc. I try to be very transparent. I think the first thing there for me is transparency, open communication. I don't want to treat another person differently from another colleague. I think fairness comes with transparency and communication. And though there could be disagreements, I think if you're transparent with your communication, eventually it will resolve itself in that situation. Second one is, I think the supportive environment is critical, because within the conflict, you will have opposing individuals, opposing groups, but if there's a supportive environment, it actually channels a lot of that negative energy towards a more positive energy in terms of to see if we can't resolve this issue. So a supportive environment is very important, and by supportive, unfortunately, a lot of companies have lots of disciplinary rules, guidelines, HR rules, anti-bullying policies, which is sometimes very bureaucratic, sometimes very much devoid of the human empathy in terms of that individual that feels that grievance or feel that conflict between two parties. So I'm talking far more than written rules and procedures. A supportive environment really comes from the leadership and what that individual then, you know, create in the environment. The other thing is also to empower the team. I was never a person that micromanaged individuals. I think it comes with the territory. I always relate myself as a bit of a Dr. House individual, very skeptical as an academic, sometimes coming over as very abrupt and sometimes aloof, but very empathetic, you know, deep down, you know, because I sometimes notice more what is not said than what is said. I sometimes question myself, how was that communication taken in by my team? And so, yes, I question myself, and I think that also empowers my teams, because I realized that my team should be able to handle many things that are, you know, I don't want to get involved with, because they've got the skills and they've got the tools to be able to do it. And then also I celebrate small wins. You know, my wife knows it. I'm a task achiever, task completer. That gives me the energy and also the inspiration for the next challenge. So if you complete something, even if it's something small, you know, even at the house, pruning a tree or, you know, backwashing the pool, and the pool is, you know, pH levels are correct and the pool is shiny, it gives you a form of satisfaction. And I think that's why in academia, I've achieved that in terms of my research as well as my teaching. It's always confidence inspiring to get feedback, positive feedback, and that recognition that you do make a difference in other people's life. I said it to a couple of people with my previous work in the corporate sector. I have to realize if I did not go to the work that particular morning, my absence wouldn't have been missed in the business numericals in terms of finances or in the output. Whereas at the university, that 30 students or 60 students, when I was teaching the first year, there was 300 students, doesn't matter. But if you don't rock up at the class, you impact all those people that are waiting for you. It's their learning experiences, it's learning progress that you are taking away. And if you don't do your work properly, you've got the impact that has lasting effects to that individual. So for me, that was very important, that small wins, achievement orientation. And I think that's why I keep also people motivated, because they realize I'm not a micromanager. I've got this internal motivation. And I think maybe we can talk about that later in the interview. But yes, I don't have really idols to say that I look towards. I think a lot of the drive that I've got internally have to do with my own achievements and seeing if I can't better myself. There's a lot of questioning that goes, and sometimes it can be your downfall if you start questioning yourself too much. But I think you need to look at your rearview mirror now and again. See if you haven't walked over other people, see if you haven't hurt other people. Also to recognize, couldn't there be a better way of dealing with individuals in the workplace? So some people will say it's maybe an insecure way of operating or leading a team. I believe it's very important to be in touch with individuals, especially from a human perspective. I think we all need a form of compassion and empathy that sometimes are totally lacking in a corporate world, where it's expected of you to be tough, to don't show emotions, and to play the rule book either through policies, procedures, etc. And I believe, off my academic background, also my will to actually challenge the status quo, I'm prone to ask questions that are benefiting a lot of the team. Sometimes to my own detriment, putting my nose out for staff, putting my nose out maybe for the client, and then realize it's to the detriment of myself because I've asked these type of questions. Yeah, so I just to come back to the previous question and then go into this question, I think for me it's more the intrinsic motivation. I've done a couple of courses in my life, and unfortunately a lot of us, and I still catch me out now and again, that I'm externally motivated with what's happening in the environment. But overall, I think my intrinsic motivation is my real northern compass, if we can call it like that, where the drive comes from within due to personal satisfaction or fulfillment that comes from achieving something. That achieving something needs to be adding value, must be meaningful. I sometimes question myself, and I think in certain workplaces, I will get very bored and stale because I don't see it as achieving something to the betterment of the organization or to the individuals that you're interacting with. That's why I think with education, especially higher education, I can see the benefits, I can feel it. And even with working with other people, we've got a kitchen here, and it's so important that the food quality must be ready for the students. I just understand how each small little element in the whole process adds up to the whole, delivery of that type of result of achieving something. So, I would say my inspiration is in setting challenging goals. I think that's why I've also taken this position as executive director at TWIMPS. I've been fortunate enough to lead a couple of business schools in the public sector, but this is the first one with a very niche focus, very small campus, but a very comprehensive offering in terms of a particular mandate. And I saw this particular challenge, and in my personal background, I would like to achieve, not just achieving the goals we set it, but exceed achieving those goals. So the process of overcoming some of obstacles that I've may encounter and that we all encounter in the workplace, that's also part of the growth. You know, sometimes you get very distraught or even negative for what you're encountering in a workplace, but it is small challenging steps that actually grow you to move you forward to achieve then this tangible results. And I think that fuels then my motivation and pushes me continuously forward. So it's also then, as I say, the journey of personal and professional growth. I'm not one that continuously put up my hand to attend all these different programs and courses that universities or even outside agencies provide for self-development or leadership development. The best place to learn something from leadership is in a workplace, and to be able to be open to feedback. So we all make mistakes. That's probably going to get to one of your other questions. Nobody is perfect, and I and myself question sometimes, am I the right person for this role? And I think it's healthy to do that. You know, if we don't do that, we're probably having more sociopaths in leadership positions, and which can be very detrimental for the organization. So, you know, this is really what inspires me, is to provide and to achieve things that enhances either the service offering, the product offering to the customer, or making the environment conducive for work to happen, to provide a safe environment for my staff to be able to fulfill their goals and aspirations as well. KZN have many challenges. You know, I've been in this province for the last 7 years now, and I've been fortunate enough to be part of a big public university with even their own challenges from a bureaucracy, a political, social culture stance that almost are infused what's happening in certain areas of KZN. So I've been exposed to a lot of these things. I've been sitting around with government as well as the private sector around the table. And I realize sometimes we talk in circles and nothing gets done. My vision really for KwaZulu-Natal is not just a region where businesses are surviving. And that's what we've been doing probably for many years. Is where we can actually thrive. How does business thrive? Is to allow the business to grow, allow the business to be able to be free from a lot of the things that we are experiencing as businesses that I've already alluded to. So that is my vision for business development, and that's why I'm involved with this institute. By this little part of education that's fostering towards manufacturing, hopefully some of the things that we teach in our classes and interact through our research and we conduct ourselves in this community, we can actually then empower some of these players in the ecosystem to be able to thrive. So I know it's impossible for a little institute to make big differences, but it's through these small ripple effects that hopefully we can actually get other players in the ecosystem to also take the challenge up. And I know there are many of them. There must be many business leaders that have decided to stay in South Africa and KwaZulu-Natal for that matter, and they would like to see the difference, not just to survive, but to be able to thrive and provide the next level of growth opportunities for this big business ecosystem. So this ecosystem will not only attract investment, as we all know, from both local and international investors, but it will also foster this growth of small, medium enterprises and startups that's so much needed in our province, especially with the high unemployment. You know, if you look at the unemployment figures, especially for KwaZulu-Natal, we need these medium enterprises, startups, to be able to absorb a lot of the graduates at universities, at colleges, but also the person that don't have the education to be able to find a proper job and not to rely on grants that, you know, with the smaller getting tax base, it's impossible to carry that for much longer. And I think that that's becoming critical for us as business leaders to actually see what we can't do to be providing opportunities in that. I think perfection belongs to no one, and you need to lead with it.